Up to this point in the course, we should be pretty comfortable with the idea of a derivative. We know what derivatives do. We know how to find them. We know that derivatives give you the slope of a function at a particular point. But it turns out we can actually go farther than taking one derivative. These are called higher order derivatives. Let me show you what I'm talking about. If f of x is your original function, the thing that I mentioned that we were very comfortable with is taking a derivative. We call it f prime, and this gives you the slope of f of x at a given x value. But you have to remember, if f of x is a function and f prime is just another function related to the original function f, there's nothing to keep us from taking his derivative. So if we want to do that, it's totally fine. We would get f, and the notation is double prime, right? So that's taking a derivative of the derivative. So this is the derivative of, not f, but of f prime. Of f prime, if I can write it correctly. Or to say it another way, that's like taking two derivatives of the original function. Now, one thing we will have to talk about a little bit is what this means. I'll start off by telling you it does not give you the slope of the original function. That's what f prime's job is. So what is his job? Well, in some sense, is to give you the derivative or the slope of the derivative graph, but that's probably not very helpful at this point. We'll get into some applications later on. But it's going to be a new function of x. In the same way, you can take another derivative and another if you wanted to keep going. The algebra is not very difficult at all. If you want to take a third derivative, you'd say prime, prime, prime. If you want to take a fourth derivative, then the notation is going to change slightly from here on out, because if you wanted, for instance, seven derivatives, you wouldn't want to say f prime, 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 prime. It would get a little too cumbersome. So the first three use the prime notation with the dashes. But for four or later, here's what we do. We say f of x, and where the primes were, you're going to put the number of derivatives you want in parentheses. The reason you have to put them in parentheses is we don't want to confuse anybody who's reading our work to make them think that we mean exponent. We don't mean exponent. We don't mean raise it to the fourth power. The parentheses notation says, hey, I want to take four derivatives of this guy. And same thing for fifth or sixth or 22nd derivative. You would just put that notation or that derivative in parentheses right there. So let's try one real quickly here. We'll just do a few until we, I guess, get tired. Here's f, 2x cubed minus 7x squared plus 5x minus 1. F prime, using basic derivative rules, would be 6x squared minus 14x plus 5. But that's a new function. So if we wanted to take f double prime, it would be 12x minus 14. That's simply the derivative of the derivative. If you wanted to take a third derivative, you'd get 12. And if you wanted to take a fourth derivative, we'll just do one more, we would get derivative of 12, which is 0. Right now, a lot of times these derivatives, as you can tell, do get smaller, but don't be fooled into thinking that they always get smaller. Some derivatives are cyclic or repeating, or they don't get smaller. For instance, a lot of trigonometric derivatives don't get smaller. Exponential derivatives, which you'll study those later in the course, they don't always get smaller, but a lot of them do, like this. Every time you take a derivative, they get smaller and smaller. Now, what do we do if we have like a trig function like this? Well, let's take a look. F prime, the derivative of sine, hopefully you know, would be cosine x. This is a trig function. And the derivative of cosine would be negative sine x. And the derivative of negative sine x would be negative cosine x. Tag along constant, that negative there. And then the fourth derivative, you'll notice something pretty odd. The derivative of cosine is negative sine, and you attach the additional negative, you get sine x again. So every four derivatives of a sine or cosine will get you right back where you started. And so you can do more and more and more derivatives. Matter of fact, I could even ask for, you know, the 400th derivative of sine or cosine. And based off of these patterns here, you could quickly figure it out without having to do them all in a row. All right, now if your notation has a y as opposed to f of x, right, which as we know, f of x and y are the same thing, but just an alternate notation, if you had a y, we know from before that the derivative is expressed as dy dx. That's the derivative of y with respect to x. Now, what's the notation if you want higher order derivatives this way? Well, it's a little bit more confusing. All right, pay close attention here. We would say the second derivative, that's where we put the 2, we put it in the upper right-hand corner of the d, the second derivative of y with respect to x, right? The second derivative of y with respect to x. But pay close attention to where the 2s are going. This 2 is between the d and the y, and this 2 is after the x. Now, how can you remember that? What's going on here? Here's one way you could think of it if you wanted to. If you recall having the derivative as an operator, right, where if you read it this way, this means I'm about to differentiate this thing to the right. Well, using this notation, you can say the second derivative with respect to x. But then if you move the y up into the numerator, you see that's where we get this notation from. So this is the second derivative with respect to x of this expression. We're going to differentiate it 2 times. In the same way, you just keep going, the third derivative of y with respect to x, and so on and so forth, and we never make any changes to that. It could be the 100th derivative of y with respect to x as well. All right, now let's close out with one application. All right, so we'll wind up studying a lot what these higher order derivatives mean. We know that this first derivative means slope. We've just discussed that a lot. But what do these guys mean? Well, truth be told, from the third derivative down, we don't use these near as often as the first two, but the second derivative actually does have a very substantial meaning. If you want to fast forward to those videos, we haven't got to it yet, but it's on concavity if you want to go ahead and fast forward to those videos. But anyways, I'll give you just one application to help you understand this. Let's say we had a function s of t that was the position of a function. So if you want to draw it on a graph, s of t compared with time, this would be like something's position in space. Well, if this is maybe let's say feet traveled per second, right? So each second we've traveled so far as this position of an object's position, then the derivative s prime would be velocity, right? Rise of a run, right? Rate of change, feet per second. Feet per second. This rate of change would mean velocity. I think we would understand that. A lot of times this is denoted as V of t, right? V of t, velocity at time t. But check this out though. If we drew the velocity graph, so here's s prime of t compared to time, and we had its graph and it was doing whatever it was doing. Well, this is feet per second. Right, this is a velocity, and time is still in seconds. So what do you have if you have a rate of change of the velocity? It's a change of so many feet per second. If maybe let's say you're slowing down, you slow down so many feet per second over a given amount of time. So if you wrote those all down, it would be feet per second per second. Now, what does that sound like? Hopefully you said feet per second squared. And if you know anything about some basic physics, that would give you acceleration, feet per second squared. So if you took the second derivative of position, it would give you acceleration. Now, another way you could say that is the first derivative of velocity, or you could just call it a of t. Now, in case that's hidden behind my picture in picture, let me scroll down a little bit. So you can see this graph here, feet per second per second. That's feet per second squared. That's acceleration. For instance, the acceleration due to gravity is negative 32 feet per second squared, or negative 9.8 meters per second squared, depending on the unit. So that's just one little taste of an application as to where you might see higher order derivatives. Now, could you continue to take derivatives? Of course you could, but that's going to be a little bit more advanced than what I want to talk about in this video as far as what those higher order derivatives mean. So hopefully that helps you understand how to take higher order derivatives and give you just a little taste as far as what they mean.